under a psalm written long ago. The words and the thoughts expressed in the song by the songwriter come from a deep search. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well.
I don't know where the angels sleep. You know, you don't need to renounce your identity to receive and follow what God would want for each one of us. We're just there. He cares deeply for each of us, and He loves the way each one of us, you and I, are put together. He loves it, and He wants to use us in a way that's consistent with the design that He made us. Our personal style answers a question on how we can function as maybe God might want us to. He did design us, after all, we believe, for each one of us to respond to our world differently, that we don't need to fit into a box. And one of the great curiosities I have is that sometimes there's this image given that if you become a God follower, or as my father has called people who go to church, God botherers, that you have to fit into this sort of box, this shape. I remember years ago when I first became a Christian, 33 years ago now, I had this impression that you had to be, if you're going to be a holy person, you had to be a holy person. In other words, you prayed so much that your knees would become holy. You had to conform, and in the congregation I was in, if you could say amen nicely, then you could join the choir. If you conformed to certain shapes, you could all dress in the same penguin habits. And the guys could look like girls in a way they never have before. And the girls could look like they were just the same as everybody else. And that's the image that is held of the church so often. And I became part of that for some time, until my Anglican vicar said to me, "Gary, you're too free a person to fit into this kind of environment." And I had to face some issues. You see, each one of us is designed to respond a little differently in this world that we live in. Therefore, each of us prefers to relate in different ways, and that's okay. There's nothing wrong with that. The problem all of us face is that we do not always function well in terms of how we relate to others and how we internally process things or experiences we might be facing. It becomes a problem to us. We often act in a way that is inappropriate, or we respond to others out of who we are without understanding why we react the way we do. As a consequence, we often feel our particular position or view is right, when in fact there is often a better or at least equivalent or more appropriate approach to the subject or situation than what we have been able to perceive. That's the reality that every one of us faces. So tonight, as we come to the subject of personality, we're going to look at the two sides of personality, the rational and the subjective sides. Now, I've purposely put this picture up here right at the beginning. It's a beautiful scene. It's got the sea and the sand and the bush. And I like to look at it very briefly, but for me personally, if I sat there for too long, I would get horribly bored. My wife would sit there with the camera. She would take photos all over the place. She would appreciate it immensely. But you give me an hour or so on there, there's not enough surf to do anything proper. There's no boat visible that I could go and do something in. It would just drive me absolutely batty. And one of the reasons is because we're so different. But one of the reasons we get along so well is because we are so different. The problem is we tend to, in conflict, and Pauline and I certainly did that in the first couple of years or year and three quarters of our marriage, we focused on the differences instead of on appreciating each other. And so today in the journey this evening, I want us to appreciate it. You see, when you look at it, how do you actually measure a person? You can't just take a rule out like this and say, well, this person's that long, they're sort of this wide between the eyes, but if they're really fit and strong, they must be this wide between the eyes because they can lift plenty. Now, we have all these perceptions about how we measure people, and we do it. We do lots of measuring. But can I say this tonight? The reality is that we often measure inappropriately, both ourselves and others. We often have understandings about ourselves that are not particularly good. Most people actually have a mixture of both rational and subjective traits. You see, every person, like with this bowler, every person will be biased to one side or other. My grandfather was a great bowler. He used to play indoor and outdoor bowls. And he used to teach me how to play. And he taught me, the first thing he taught me with the bowl was that I had to hold it in the hand like this. And he said, if I want the ball to go to the kitty that was over here, I had to make sure I didn't bowl at the kitty. I had to bowl slightly away from it with a bias in the middle, and the ball would curl around very graciously to the kitty ball. And I'd try and stop it as close as I possibly could to that ball. If I wanted to approach it from the other side because there was a ball in the way, I'd have to turn the bowl over the other side, put the bias on this side, and bowl it that way and curl it in like that. And the truth of the matter is that every one of us has a bias of some kind or another. Most of us have a mixture. Some of us don't. Some of us have a mixture that's very healthy, and some of us have a mixture that is extremely unhealthy, and I'm going to touch on that a little later. But I want to say this before I go any further, and I want to correct something that sits in our society that is so destructive it's not helpful at all. There is no trait that is better or more important than the other. There is an impression amongst people, particularly amongst those who tend to be rational, that they are better than the subjective people. Rational people tend to think that because the way their minds work, they tend to think, oh, because I have everything in order and the subjective person doesn't seem to have everything in order, I can just blow it. You know? Just because that's the way it goes. And I just want to say quite clearly right now that we cannot see that as being the truth based on the way that God's made us. See, each one of us is made differently. And a rational person is no better than a subjective person, and vice versa. And I want to touch on the reasons why that might be a little later. But I want to start with this at the beginning, because many subjective people often go around feeling as if the rational people think they're better. Some of them do. Naughty, naughty. That's really the truth of it. You want to put it down a bottom line? It's bad news. And then the second thing I want to say in terms of this whole deal is that personality traits are actually changeable. Because you start off as a purely subjective person or a purely rational person doesn't mean to say by the end of your life that you're going to be a purely subjective or a purely rational person. In fact, one would hope that you're not going to be. Because may the Lord help you through your life if you stay like that. You're in trouble. You see, it's possible for us to have growth, just like with these trees. There's stages through our lives that we go through where we can have growth. In fact, can I tell you this? That the change can be so significant that by the time you're a little older, you can almost be unrecognizable as the same person, given the right kinds of situations. But I want to briefly look at some of the subjective traits first, and then I want to look at the rational traits. I've started with the subjectives first because the fact that the rationals tend to want to start with the rationals first, so I'm doing it in reverse order just so that subjective people feel real good. Now, you'll notice, if you're really observant, that in actual fact some of the advantage traits of subjective are actually higher number of them than there are rational ones. Let's have a look at it. Let's obey me first. There we go. The first one. A subjective person usually makes decisions based on what they feel is good. They usually make decisions based on what they feel is good. That's a trait. And that can be good or bad, but it's one of the aspects of them. Their moods are easily affected by things happening around them. They tend to take things very personally, whether criticisms or compliments. And before any subjectives jump on me for this, please hear me clearly. That's okay to actually do that if your responses are okay. Because sometimes things need to be taken personally. Sometimes the rational person doesn't take things personally enough. They usually follow their heart over their mind. When they feel good, they feel really good. And when they feel bad, they feel really bad. And everybody knows it. Does anybody know who this person here is on the screen? My daughter knows who it is. It's a caricature of somebody in the church. You're allowed to say. Florence, yeah, well done. Give him a hand. Come on. Adele changed the colours and everything to make it look right for me. Right. They like to know why, even when there may be no clear explanation. They like to know why, even when there may be no clear explanation. I've got to tell you this one. This one here, this last one, in relation to subjects, is the one that's driven me most crazy whenever I've had difficulty with talking with subjective people. Because I find there's a desire to know why, but sometimes there isn't an answer. And it's a difficult one to deal with, both for a subjective or for a rational person. So that's a bit of a fun one, really. Now let's come to the rational. Who's that there? I'm saying it's Gary, come on. Okay, I didn't know who that one was, I was just asking your opinion. Okay, Adele told me who the other one was. So here we are, the rational traits, here they are. They tend to make their decisions based on a process of thinking and logic. Okay. They take into consideration possible consequences before doing anything. And let me tell you this. This is both a strength and a weakness. And we'll deal with that a little later. They tend to not get emotionally involved in situations. They tend not to swing rapidly through emotional extremes. They enjoy resolving complex issues. All right, now we know people are starting to warm to this. It's good, isn't it? Right? So they're the rational traits that we actually face. They're the things that are there. Now I'm going to get Adele to come up here now because I want to cover the aspect of subjective weaknesses. So we're going to do the subjectives first, and then we're going to do the subjective strengths, and then we're going to cover the rational weaknesses and the rational strengths. So here comes Adele. She's going to tell you a little story.
Started seeing problems in everything else around him, not just the problem that had happened, but everything else that was fine before suddenly had problems in it. And the little ant started pushing all his problems into a big pile of woe. So he's pushing all his little problems, if you can imagine a little ant, pushing them all together, making a big pile of problems. And the little ant climbs to the top of his pile of problems, and he sits down, and he goes, or the other option is he sits there and he goes, woo, feeling very sorry for himself. And I've forgotten the end of the story. Yeah, that's what that little ant does. And he just, that's the end of the story. That's where he ends off. Not a very happy little ant.
Let's give her a hand. Thank you so much. Well, I thought I'd get Adele to tell that story because I didn't think I could tell it quite as well as her. You see, the weaknesses of subjectives is that they sometimes get too emotionally involved, which interferes with their ability to make wise decisions. Emotional involvement can sometimes be very destructive. The second one is they are more likely to make choices without considering the long-term consequences. They can find it hard to listen to others when they have an opinion. They tend to lack discretion, and due to this, they find it hard to keep secrets or be confidential, and can end up leaving people with a lack of confidence in them. They will tend to have extremes of emotion. When the person takes a negative extreme, it often leaves others not sure what to think, frustrated or even angry. When they are in a bad mood, they are in a bad mood. They can get into a vicious cycle of negativity, can become unable and unwilling to listen. They can lose the ability to think clearly, rationally and sensibly. Of course, that's the rational viewpoint of the whole thing, isn't it? They can lose all sense of perspective without even realizing it. That's the way a subjective person is. Now, I purposely didn't put them up on the screen because I didn't really want to dump those things on you. Just to pass the basic essence that this emotional attachment to the way we respond is actually quite destructive if it's our weakness, if we don't respond in appropriate ways. And one of the most difficult things that I find is the number of people that, because of this Western worldview that the rationals are better than the subjectives, the number of people that perceive themselves to be rationals when in actual fact they're subjectives, which is the point of Adele's little story. The two afterwards, after Adele finished telling her story, she reported to me, they says, that's us. See, we don't like to think we're something we're not. You know one of the funniest things about it? Some of us who are more rationally biased would love to be able to be more expressive emotionally. Although we sometimes find the emotional thing a problem. You know, it's a difficult thing. So I now want to really move on from this and look at the strengths of the subjective person, because I want to finish with this good note for the subjectives right now. Here they are. The subjective strengths. The first one is they are able to relate very well to others. Much better than most rational people. They're good in relationships. They respond with their heart to the needs of others and get good results very often. People will enjoy being around them when they're in a good mood. But oh hang if they're not. They are in touch with their emotional side. This enables them to readily respond and be a support in a variety of situations that a rational person just can't even, the rational person just flounders in those situations. Their desire to know why will sometimes mean that people are willing to talk with them about things that they wouldn't discuss otherwise. So even though it's a weakness, it can also be a strength. So that's really the bottom line with our people, our subjective strengths. Pretty good stuff. Because without the subjectives, we would not have a community that learns how to love properly. Subjective people teach rational people heaps about loving. Let's look now at rational weaknesses. And seeing as we had an ant for one, we thought about what the rationals are like. And this is a rational, and I'm afraid I'm going to have to own some of this, because here they are, the weaknesses of the rational. We see a hedgehog, as we shall call him here. Hedgehog is a classic case of the rational. You can see him so clearly because you look at his weaknesses. Most people will see the rational person as a person who is close, who's difficult to get close to. Facts are too important. They miss the point of people's felt needs. You guys aren't even getting the jokes here. When dealing with people, they feel they have all the points right. They're curled up in their own mindset when trouble hits, and they tend to be difficult to move or to shift. That's hedgehog. Here are the weaknesses listed as I have them. They can find it hard to relate to others. The prickliness of their nature sometimes comes through very strongly. They can be insensitive to the needs of others without realising it, or because they just don't care. I don't care. I've heard people say this now and again. Every now and again, there's somebody who's a little subjective, gets upset or whatever, and you'll get a rational person who comes along and they'll say, oh, that's their problem. That's their problem, yeah. Just as straight as that. I'm not going to be bothered about it. It's their problem. How heartless can you get, rationals? Join me. Get over it, yeah. It's the way it goes. They tend to be defined difficult to get in touch with and express their emotions or feelings. They can find it hard to be expressive in their worship. A lot of rational people want everything to be set in certain order, and they find it hard to be expressive. And a lot of rational people, because a lot of churches, listen to this carefully, people, because a lot of churches allow the subjective people a lot more freedom in worship than perhaps I think is wise at times, because it shuts down the rationals. What happens? Rational people go, I can't cope with this. I can't figure this out. I don't understand it. I don't understand. I got a wee breathing problem at the moment. I just can't understand this whole deal. And that's the way that they will respond. A rational person just can't get their heads around what other people might be trying to do in worship. I think it's wise to allow moments when silence is there so that a rational person can think through things and maybe respond to God and get in touch with their feelings. But they don't do it because it's all bubbly and alive. They do it because they've worked through what it all means, how significant it is. Some of you know me well enough to know that I believe that worship needs to be well structured. And the reason I believe that is because you need to think through a roller coaster ride. For those of you who are not Christians or visitors here, you might understand this if you've seen it from the outside. They go to church and they talk and they start singing. They sing, I love you, Lord. And it's very deep and meaningful, obviously, for all the Christians that are there. Well, some of them don't seem to be taking part. And then suddenly they go, great joy, yeah, 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 yeah. And it's all the celebration stuff. And then it goes, God, you're so special to me. You know, amazing grace as we eat the psalm. And then it goes, rah, 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 rah. And then he goes, you know what that feels like to me as a rational person? When I come out of a church service like that, I feel like I've been on a roller coaster ride. And you know what roller coaster rides do to me? They make me puke. And so what has to happen is that both the rational and the subjective people have to be thought about in life, not just in worship, but all aspects of life. And we need to work through those kinds of things. They often miss the point of other people's felt needs. When dealing with problems or issues, they often leave people feeling they haven't been heard or understood properly, which complicates matters rather than resolving them. The rational person will sit there saying, I'm listening to you. Yes, yes, I've got you. Thank you very much. Now, the decision we're going to make, we'll continue with that one. I haven't heard a darn thing you've said, in other words. I'm just going to continue on the way I'm going. That's a rational person. I've already made my mind up before I even heard you, and listening to you was a polite exercise of ignorance. They often leave subjective people feeling that they are wrong. That's why subjective people often feel that rational people think they're superior, because they often leave subjective people feeling that they are wrong. Whereas if they had incorporated the subjective person's ideas, they would have come to a better solution or understanding of the situation they are actually facing. And the last one, they become locked into their own mindset of what is right, and because of it end up in conflict, and often with other rational people as well. This is right and you will do this. And the other rational person in the room saying, no, my one's right and we will do this. And the subjective person saying, but I feel that we need to consider this. And you've got a mess in the room. It only takes two people to create a mess, three people to create a catastrophe. Now that's the way it happens. So now that I've picked on the rationals a little bit and the subjectives have had a good laugh, Let's look at their strengths. The rational strengths. The first one, they find it easy to make carefully thought through decisions. They are good at processing information, so they don't find it too hard. You give them a jigsaw puzzle, and they, if they're particularly interested in that type of thing, and they will sit there for hours until they've solved the problem. Whether it's a jigsaw like this or whether it's some other problem, they will love to do it. Second one is, they are unlikely to experience many extreme lows. Sorry, I couldn't read that. I should have read it with you. They are unlikely to experience many extreme lows. Now and again, you'll get a rational person who will have an emotional collapse or failure or breakdown, and they'll have a really serious bad time. But mostly rational people don't face those extremes. They're pretty evenly keeled. They don't go from one extreme to the other. They can have a late night and wake up the next morning, if they're good, healthy rationals, feeling fine, even though they only had very little sleep. Those kinds of things are very real for a rational person. The next one is, they are not dictated to by their own emotions. They're not dictated to by their emotions. So they're not controlled by their emotions. We have a mixture in our family that's just so amazing. But it's been great compliment. We've got one daughter on one side who's totally out there on the subjective side, and another daughter who's totally out there on the rational side. And then we've got Sailor who's come in there, and I'm never quite sure where Sailor sits sometimes. But it's great. We have a great time together. The next one, they're able to maintain long-term perspectives even when others around them may be despairing. As one of the things that's happened to me, you know, Johanna will often come to me and say, "Oh, Dad, there was a few people away from church this morning. It was really hard, wasn't it?" And I'm saying, "No, I know why they weren't there this morning. This happened classically this morning. Johanna wasn't here, so I can use this application here. If she'd been here this morning," she said, "Dad," she actually asked me on the phone this afternoon, "how many were at church this morning?" I said, "Oh, there was a few people away this morning." "Oh, Dad, why?" She wants to know the reason why. I could give her the answer. I said, "Because I know why. I was preaching on demonology and that, and Satan certainly wasn't going to let them hear that one, and he was going to keep them away if he could, and some of you were courageous enough to beat him and be here. Well done." Well, for those of you who are visitors, in terms of that, that's a bit of a strange thing, but, you know, it's amazing. People didn't know what I was preaching on, but the number of times I'm preaching on a hairy subject like that, that people don't turn up, it's just phenomenal. You see, because of that, I'm able to look at it and say, and I'm able to say to Johanna or to any other subjective people, "It's all right, I know how to deal with it. We're going to get through this thing. We're going to help people see. I'm going to send them all a letter." I don't send letters, but I've decided I'm going to. All right? See, the rational's response is to address it differently. All right. I'm just going to say, "Hey, you guys, did you realize you were suckered by Satan?" That's not a nice thought, is it? No. Well, in the secular world, they have similar type of paradigms. It's just that they don't understand the spiritual, or don't want to accept the spiritual, and so they will have similar issues, and they'll have all sorts of other ways of addressing it. And then the last one, they do not give up easily. You know, one of the things that I find, I got teased. Well, one of my fellow pastors, he's a well-known pastor in New Zealand of a rather large church, he decided that I was a person that he hadn't, he actually hadn't understood who I was. And so he had decided that he was going to feel good if he asked me how many sermons I prepare ahead, how much planning I do during the year, because he was pretty convinced, he's admitted to me since, in his own mind, that I was the kind of guy that I could get up there and preach on the spur of the moment, and you know, and so I'd probably just preparing each week. That was his impression. He'd just been to a conference where they said that the pastor sits down at the beginning of the year and he spends 2 weeks solidly planning for a whole year. So this guy who wanted to bolster his own confidence said to me, "How long do you prepare ahead for your messages when you're preaching?" I said, "Well, we do it differently in our seeker services. Well, at the moment, Seeker services, we're planning. Sometimes I said we've gotten as far as 28 weeks ahead, we're planning. I don't know whether I want to hear the rest of this, he said to me. Very strong, rational man. And I said, for our worship services, well, I said, at the moment I'm in the middle of a series. We're about 10 weeks out from the end of the series, and I'm looking at another series after that. I definitely don't want to hear this. His staff were sitting there. They know him really well. They're all sitting there around the table with us eating tea, and they sat there and they mocked him. They gave him watto. Some of them were subjectives who were delighting in a rational guy going down in flames, their senior pastor. You see, we tend to be like that as humans. If somebody's going to be exposed to be weak in some area, to misjudge something, especially if it's a rational person, subjectives and some other rationals will delight in enjoying the moment. But oh boy, it gets tricky sometimes. And it gets tricky if you go the other way. If it's a subjective thing and a subjective response, the rational people find themselves suddenly out of depth, and somebody in the middle of the room bursts into tears, and the rational person's sitting there, what did I do? Duh. Slow. We often, as rational people, don't even realise that we've gone past the boundaries and we've created a problem. So we do not easily give up in the rational strength. So that's the last one. Now I want to come to some tips in terms of this. And in terms of looking at the tips, whoops. Oh, that's right. No, I'm not going to do tips first. I changed it last minute. I needed to do this first, I realised. In terms of looking at this whole deal, what I want to do tonight is to address it in terms of how we are made, who we are, what we might be. In Texas, there was a blind man who decided to visit Texas. He went to Texas. He went to big Texas. Everything in Texas is considered to be big. As he arrived on the plane, he mentioned to the flight attendant that it had been a very comfortable flight. He said, wow, these seats are big. And she replied, everything is big in Texas. And once he had settled into his hotel room, he decided to go downstairs to the bar. He ordered a beer and had a mug placed between his hands. He exclaimed, well, these mugs are big. The bartender replied, everything is big in Texas. After a couple of beers, the blind man asked the bartender where the bathroom was located. The bartender replied, second door to the right. The blind man had some difficulty finding it and headed for the bathroom, but missed the second door and instead went out a third door that led to the swimming pool, which he promptly fell into. As he came up for air, you could hear him cry out, don't flush, don't flush! See, everything is big in Texas. The trouble is that sometimes the extremes we live under are a little like that. You see, I want to look at this whole thing here and look at both the subjective and the rational extremes. And at both ends, you've got weaknesses, and in the middle, you've got strengths. Now, the only person I know of who actually has really modeled the strengths of both the rational and the subjective is Jesus Christ. Now, I can say that with integrity, having studied in two colleges about him a lot, and having since then read very much the scripture and gone through some of his responses, or all of his responses that are recorded, been recorded. And one of the things I notice is that as I've gotten older, I've moved in myself. You see, you'll be a little surprised, some of you, to know that when I married Pauline, I actually thought I was down this end of the scale. That was my perceptions about myself, and that was partly because of the abuse and things that went along with the alcoholism in my family. I was somewhat surprised as my life went on in journey to discover that in actual fact I was strongly on this side, but I had some of the weaknesses of this side. In actual fact, when I looked at it, I had the weaknesses of both sides, but I had a greater amount of weaknesses of this side than I did of that side. Because we get in an argument with Pauline, I would get in an argument with Pauline, and I would say, da-da-da-da-da, and I'd quote some situation that had happened 9 months ago. An argument we'd had, I'd remember precisely all the details, I'd be able to quote it verbatim to her, exactly what had happened. And Pauline would look blankly at me and say, I don't remember that. When I forgave you for that, I forgot it all. Boy, that used to get me mad. How dare she forget one of our fights? You see, that was me in the weakness here. Her subjective side can be real fun sometimes. But I can tell you this. Both of us, Pauline has grown this way and I've grown this way. Now, I don't want to tell you where Pauline is on the chart because that would be up to her to try and define for you. But I think for myself, I've come somewhat down here somewhere because one of the things that's happened for me is that I've been able to express myself much more emotionally, especially since I've been in Porirua, than I have in the rest of my life. I'm now 50 years old and still looking young, and you know, things are going well. I'm enjoying life, but I'm also very aware that some of those weaknesses are still there. When I'm listening to subjective people, I really have to fight within myself to move myself across to that side rather than try and see everything from this side. It is not an easy task for me. I really have to work at it. And each one of us will find ourselves in that kind of situation. We are often misunderstood in some of those situations. You know, blondes are often picked on. There's all these blonde jokes around. I actually don't think it's actually got anything to do with being blonde, in case some of you have got black hair, thought you were going to be safe. But I think the expression, she was so blonde, doesn't refer to somebody with hair that's blonde colour, but in terms of responses. See, some people can be so subjective that they don't actually notice the detail. And it was said that she was so blonde, she told me to meet me at the corner of the walk and don't walk. Some of you got it. Give him a hand. He got it. Come on. Did you get it? See, I think more subjective people probably responded to it than rational people. The walk and don't walk sign, you know, the one that keeps changing? On every corner, of course. There was a woman who, Diane, who found herself to be pregnant, and she told the good news to anyone who would listen. Her four-year-old son listened with intrigue to his parents' conversations about the impending birth of the little baby that was coming along. And one day when Diane and her son were shopping, a woman asked the little boy if he was excited about the new baby, which other people are prone to do. I'd upload if I know why they do, because they always get the weirdest answers, but that's the way it went. Yes, said the little boy, he was excited about this new baby. And I don't know what they're going to name him as well. Name the child as well. And the lady said, well, what are they going to name the little baby? And the little boy said, well, if it's a girl, we're going to call him Christina. Call her Christina. And if it's another boy, we're going to call it quits. You see, sometimes the message we communicate gets missed because the person listening doesn't have the ability to actually see things. And when you look at this, I just want to mention this one thing here. Some people have the weaknesses of both sides with little strength in the middle. So please, if you're a rational subjective people, don't feel that you're at this end or that end on its own. You can be both ends weak. Isn't that fun? Or you can be strong in the middle. Now my desire would be to be like Jesus. You know that passage that was read tonight by Anne was so clear. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Even my inmost thoughts are known by God. And I'd love to be here. I'd love to be able to be as free as a bird as a subjective person without the weaknesses. I'd love to be as free as a bird as a rational person without the weaknesses, both sides. I'd love to be able to enjoy those moments, but the reality is that that's not what I'm like. The reality is I tend to be towards one side more than I really want to be. So what do I do? Well, I do have some tips here tonight that we can look at. Let's have a look at those tips. First of all, I want to cover the tips for the subjectives. And I've lost my page momentarily. I've totally lost my page momentarily. Here we go. When feeling negative, make a conscious decision to say, things are going to be okay. I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to enjoy this moment. It's counter your nature, I know. But you can actually do it. In fact, the people I know that are able to do it, who are subjective by nature, actually are incredibly successful people. When you are not feeling in a good place, go get some encouraging people to pray for you or to care for you or to support you without giving them lots of explanation. Because if you go to them and you're all subjective and you're feeling things are not in a good place, you know your temptation as a subjective person is to go to the person and go, blah. By the time you're finished, they don't want to hear anymore. And they're not certainly going to have much energy to encourage you. Tell them as little as you can. Just say, I'm finding things really hard right now. Can you sort of give me a hand here? Or can you pray for me? And I recommend, for those of you who are not used to that kind of journey, that the experience of coming in contact with God is one of the most fulfilling things I've ever had in my life. And I lived quite a few years without God, so I know what it means to be without it. The next one, the next tip, give yourself time when making decisions. Don't feel that things have got to be decided now. Just because the boss or somebody in your home or somebody else says, it's got to be done now, it doesn't have to be done now. If the telephone rings, you don't have to answer it now. I always remember one guy who gave me an incredible revelation one day, speaking in a conference. It was probably one of the most powerful things he said. He didn't say a great lot of other good things in that particular conference, but there's one thing he said, you are not honor-bound to Alexander Graham Bell. You don't have to answer this thing. Just be grateful that his name wasn't Alexander Graham Siren. You don't need to respond to the ever-present now. That's a subjective response. You need to give time for making decisions. And when thinking about issues, write down the positives and negatives as this will help you be objective. Don't just write down all the negatives or try to write down positives just on their own. Try to be balanced in that thing and it'll help you grow on that chart that we showed before. Develop strong listening skills. Spend some time consciously sitting there saying, In fact, could I recommend this? God made us with two ears and one mouth. Keep that in balance and you'll make a good life of things. Listen twice as much as you speak and it'll help. Heaps. It's no accident that we haven't got two mouths. The Lord help us if anybody was born with two mouths. If you notice others are indicating that there is a problem, be humble and open to what God might be saying. And that they might be saying to you. If you find that you're feeling negative, try getting some early nights. You may be surprised at the difference it makes. We've had this one in both our present family and my family as we grew up. Some of my family, when I was younger, were totally disasters. If they had a late night, they were about the worst thing the next morning to live with. It's terrible. Subjective people need to learn that you do need sleep if you're emotional based in your responses. The reason being is because emotional response drains your energy quite highly. And so if you then have late nights on top of it, of course it's going to do some damage. So there are some tips for the subjective people. And I'd like you all of you to give a hand to all the subjectives that are here tonight. Let's now come to the tips for the rational people. You need, listen to this carefully, whether you know God or not, you need to allow God and His Holy Spirit to be really involved in your life. Expect Him to move in power through you and be available to His ability to actually guide and lead you and help you. Your temptation will be to be self-dependent. And that includes people inside and outside the church. And our society has been biased towards rational. And so many people consider themselves to be rational when they're actually subjectives. I have had over the years a number of people say to me, I'm a rational person. And I'm sitting there thinking, how do I tell them? And sometimes it's wiser for me just to shut up and not try to tell them at all. On that occasion, wait for another day. The rational mind says to me, right now it would be the worst thing to do. It would be like putting a match to petrol. Just shut up, Colville, and lay low. But the reality is that people who are subjective often perceive themselves to be rational because they think to be rational is to be better. It is not. You hear that first point, that first tip that for the rationals there, and you will know for sure that the rationals get into deep trouble and serious waters. You will need to spend considerable time and effort developing healthy relationships, because rational people don't. They only tend to develop passing relationships. You will need to, when making significant decisions that will affect others, you would be wise to consult widely and prayerfully so that others can have the opportunity to contribute and have a sense of ownership. Because if you don't, you're going to run across people who are subjective or rational who may not have the ability that you have, and you'll go, oh, okay, this is what's going to happen, da-da-da-da-da. Everybody okay with this? And everybody will sit there going, gee whiz, I'm not going to challenge this one. Yeah, it's all right. And then they go away to their offices, or they go away in their home, or they go away wherever they are, and they say, man, doesn't that guy listen to us? Why didn't he ask us what we thought? And I can tell some of you here work in workplaces or in education institutions or whatever where you know that the boss is like this. You know, your wisest tip I can give you at this point is to go to them not during a confrontation issue, not over a confrontation issue, because they will bring the power thing in. To go in when there's no issue and say, look, I'd just like to have a talk. And to sit down with the rational person and say to the rational person, look, I'm just having some difficulty here. When we have discussions, they're not discussions, they're kind of one-sided things. You bring the ideas, and I know you really love what you're doing, and we appreciate you trying to do the best, but could you please spend some time listening to us? Because that's what a rational person needs to do. If you noticed, one of the actions of Jesus in the Bible that he constantly did, he constantly listened to people. And because he listened so carefully, he was very incisive. When they came to him trying to be shrewd, they came to him, for example, with money, the money issue, and they said, should you pay taxes or shouldn't you? Jesus' answer said to me, give me a coin. They got a coin, and he looked at it and thought very deeply, turned it over, and he said, whose inscription's on it? They said, Caesar's. So he very wisely said, listen to it. He said, render to Caesar's that which is Caesar's, and to God that which is God's. What was he saying? He really dug under the really subjective issue that was going on here. They wanted to kill him. They wanted an excuse to get the Roman soldiers to kill him instead of them doing it themselves. So if they could get him to say, no, you don't pay taxes to Caesar, they had him. But what a shrewd answer, because he stopped and he listened and he thought and he said, render to Caesar that which is Caesar, and to God that which is God. Everything belongs to God, really. What a trap answer. What a good answer. I like it. It appeals to my sort of my mind, you know. Then avoid prejudging people who don't express themselves with your style of logic and rationale. Don't go in and say, I know that Mary Jane's gonna, she's gonna come out with all this fluffy stuff. Now, I've got to confess to you, I haven't done it for a long time, but I've done it. I've known that somebody's gonna be in a meeting. I thought, oh, we're gonna have to survive the fluffy stuff. That's what I call the fluffy stuff. All the emotive stuff. Oh, if we do this, it'll make everybody feel lovely. All right. But it won't look good. Oh, but it'll feel lovely. But it won't work well. Oh, but it'll feel lovely. That drives a rational person totally insane. But rational people need to listen to that, because feeling lovely is important to a high percentage of our population, isn't it? Amen? Then the last one. Be patient with those who don't immediately understand your ideas. Be patient. Don't race things. Don't feel compelled that you've got to keep moving. Don't feel that things have got to be moving on because you've decided they've got to be moving on. You need to be people who are going to be careful. You're going to take it carefully. You're going to look at it carefully. You know, the real end result of the whole thing is, I believe empirically, and I believe absolutely, that God made us. I don't buy the evolutionary hypothesis whatsoever. I think I could prove it, and we've done a series on this in the past, on the whole evolutionary theory, and there's a lot of scientists now dumping the whole theory due to Mount St. Helens explosion and some other issues that happened. I think the psalmist was right. Oh Lord, you have searched me, and you know me. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. And you know what the psalmist was saying? He's saying, I accept who I am. I know who you intended me to be, to some degree. I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. And because of it, I respect your desires, God, in my life. And I'm willing to do the things that are best for me. There's two more scriptures I'd like to finish with tonight. The Bible clearly says in the book of Romans, Paul's writing to the people, the Roman people, and he says this, the mind of the sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit of God is life and peace. And I want to say this, there are some people that claim to be Christians that don't seem to have that life and peace, and I want to say this really clearly. There's an absence of the Spirit if there's an absence of those two things, because the Scripture clearly says that you can have life and peace if you've got the mind of the Spirit of God. But there's many of us here who sometimes have had peace and sometimes haven't had peace. Sometimes we've never had much peace, or we've had little peace and we haven't really appreciated how much peace and life that we can really have. And you know, God would want every one of us here in this room to experience the power of that. And I'll finish with this reading. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world as it is, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, whether you're subjective or rational, I would put in. Then you will be able to attest and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will, which he has for everyone here. See, the reality is that at the end of the day, you are designed to be excellent, not mediocre in life. That's the design. And I want to say, go to it. Discover it. Face the challenges. And if you're not sure whether you're rational or subjective or whatever, go and see Adele and she'll put you through the computer thing. See, the reality is, every one of us in the room, we need to change. We're weak in some areas. Sometimes we're weak on our relationship with God, and sometimes we're weak on our relationship with other people. The reason we're weak in those things is because we haven't got the deal sorted out fully. That's really the reason. We start to get that sorted out even better, We stop picking on other people, we start having a better attitude. And that's actually part of loving each other, which is what God wants. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And the second is this, that you shall love your neighbour as you love yourself. And if you don't love yourself, you cannot love your neighbour and you cannot love God. But you've got to start somewhere. Some of you have started the journey. Some of you are wee way down the journey. Some of you only just started the journey. You're further down the journey than some of them have been in a long time in the journey. That's the way it is in Christian life. But God wants every one of us to be just like Jesus and to enjoy life the way he designed us to. Let's talk to God about it. And if you'd like to pray with me, at the end of it I'm going to say, and all the people said, and you can say amen if you agree. Don't feel compelled to say amen. Father God, we come to you and sometimes we haven't understood just how wonderfully made we are. Often we've just looked at our own weaknesses and our own failings when we have had reflective moments and we have wanted to kick ourselves in despair. There are other times we've looked and we've enjoyed who you've made us to be, but we haven't always appreciated that that's who you've made us. And so we come to you tonight, and we want to say, God, that you can be the one who is going to rule and reign. And more than anything, we recognize that we need shaping and we need molding. Your scriptures say that we need transforming. And we really would like to be the perfect person, but we know that's just not within our reach in the natural. And so we'd ask for your help that we might begin the process even more than we've ever had before in our lives tonight. So help us to see the perspectives that you would have on this and guide us with your grace and your mercy and your love. Forgive us for the times we've failed, we pray in Jesus' name. And all the people said, all the people said,
well, let's show a big round of applause for our team. We've done it.